Alamance County is pleased to present the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.
I'll come to order, and I will ask Commissioner Boswell if he will lead us in our invocation, please.
Let's bow our heads, please. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you so much for the blessings you have given us. Thank you for the rain that helps our crops grow. Dear Father, be with our troops as they are overseas and here at home protecting us for the freedoms that we share tonight in this meeting, actually. Dear God, just be with them, look over them, protect them, bring them home safely. And dear God, be with us tonight as we make decisions concerning the county's business. Let us make the wise choices that need to be made. These things we ask in Christ's name. Amen.
Amen.
Okay. At this time, we'll have our public comments. Beverly Kerr, just to remind you, it's a three-minute comment.
Good evening. I'm Beverly Kerr from Alamance County. And tonight I'm talking to you as communications coordinator for Blue Ridge Environmental Defense League. And I have just a few things to say about recently we had a press conference at Elon, and Brettel released its report, The Importance of Sustainable Development in Troubled Economic Times. The new report provides a blueprint for community planning. The League also presented a list of recommendations for economic development, which protect the health and quality of life of present and future residents and the natural and cultural resources of Alamance County. The report was released at this time to encourage public participation and discussion at upcoming hearings hosted by the Alamance County Planning Department. Brettel supports the ordinance that has been regulating polluting industry locations since 2006. There is a real concern that the ordinance is under attack. A subcommittee of the Planning Board is meeting and holding public hearings every Wednesday through June the 8th at 2:30 in the conference room at 217 College Street in Graham. Copies of the existing ordinance are available on the Alamance County website. The ordinance prevents junkyards, racetracks, swine mega farms, waste processing facilities, chemical manufacturers, mining operations, cement facilities, landfills, chip mills, electricity generating facilities, fuel bulk storage facilities, medical waste facilities, and asphalt plants from locating within 2,000 feet of a school, child daycare center, nursing home, church, or residential development. Government and citizens alike may be tempted to accept less than desirable polluting industries, which would not ordinarily be welcomed. The League calls for continued support of the Alamance County Land Development Plan and the Destination Plan featured on the Alamance County website, which encourages quality development that reflects community values and recommends discouraging industries producing excessive noise, odor, air, and water pollution, or other harmful impacts. Your attendance and participation is also needed at the Economic Development Summit with other local leaders and citizens this Thursday, May the 19th, at the Twin Lakes Community Wellness Center, 3711 Wade Coble Drive, Burlington. Please read the Brettel Report and attend the meeting to share any concerns you may have about future development plans. There are many essential needs for our county, but more pollution is not among them. Please take the time to visit our website, brettel.org, to view the following online. You can read our press report, the report, The Importance of Sustainable Development in Troubled Economic Times, and recommendations for Alamance County.
Thank you.
And tonight I brought you all of this information, and there's copies for the commissioners, the planning manager, and chair of the
county. Okay, is there any comments from the commissioners? Any responses? Any questions? Okay, we'll go on to number five, and Mr. Owen, would you like to come forward, please? And we will hear what you have to say, sir.
No,
Madam Chairperson and Commission members, let me first introduce one of my bosses. Cecilia Fawcett is here, and Bob Harker is here also. Always identify your bosses, I've learned over the years. We're here tonight to speak about a potential resolution. Our city council has challenged us, the staff, and asked us to look at the possibility of the extension of Rockwood Avenue. It's only about a mile, but it's a complicated project in terms of some of our water issues we'll be dealing with. And while we're in the midst of determining what all of our challenges are, the one thing we do know is going to be a costly project. We can assure you that. So we're asking a resolution that we send to Raleigh and take to our legislators, hoping to get some support from the General Assembly on this project. I'll be glad to answer any questions you got. I'll be brief because I know you've got other things on your agenda tonight.
Anybody got any questions for Mr. Owen?
Can we roll the clock back a second? Wasn't Rockwood O'Neill originally supposed to be part of an inner loop in the city, and Graham as well, an inner loop? Do you remember that?
Well, the outer loop has been, the final peg of that's been finished now. That would go around Glen Raven and tie back into University Drive. That would tie back in and tie back into Graham if that ever would be extended. This is really a north-south connector, what this is, to try to get people from the northern part of the county in. Chapel Hill Road is on the TIP, but why this project's going to be so expensive, Commissioner Sutton, is that we'll be having to do work at Webb Avenue, Front Street, and Church Street. To look to handle potential traffic we think will be coming that way. This is one. It's not a state project. This is going to be. We're asking for some state money, but this is going to be primarily a city project. So we're looking at public and private partners both. And if you all would like to partner, we certainly would like to have some of your money too. But that's not our primary reason here tonight. It's going to be an interesting project if we can.
I support it. I was just curious. My memory, if it serves me correctly, there was supposed to be an inner loop in the city, in Graham, and Graham City Council voted down 3-2 their portion of it. Do you remember that?
Bob, you remember that?
Is that not correct?
I think that's correct, yeah.
Yeah, and it was going to be an inner loop, and Graham had some houses, and they didn't want to condemn them or something, and the vote was 3-2 not to do their portion. And then y'all went ahead, and I'm glad you did. Or somebody went ahead and built what's now built. It runs behind Turntime. Mm. And
that wasn't built without controversy either, if you remember.
Yeah.
But then with Chapel Hill Road being widening, that will really basically take it from Church to it, the edge of the city limits of Graham, close to it. We feel like a lot of traffic here will be coming through and turning right on Church Street, and then our next challenge would be Alamance Road. Get that widened from Church to Mebane Street. It's already widened from Mebane Street to the interstate.
Is it going to be the same configuration, design, one lane?
Possibly. We haven't quite got that far yet. We got some issues there with remedying some water issues,
right,
that we know we'll be dealing with. So that's why a lot of this is still very preliminary, except we all know it's going to be expensive, I can assure you.
Do you look to see a tax increase? Or can you use taxes for that?
We're certainly not that far. I don't think there'd be a tax increase. I think we'd have to use capital reserves.
Yeah, okay.
And then, again, we try to work with some. We got some private partners interested in doing some things, and then certainly attempting to find as many public partners as we can at the state level. DOT, while it's not going to be a DOT project, I think they're willing to work with us some. It's still very preliminary right now.
Okay.
I'd like to make a comment to Harold, if I could.
Sure.
As someone that travels there virtually every day, as you do, if you are on Church Street around the Cameron Corner area or even coming from the interstate on 62, you can't get to 87.
That's right.
Either up on, pardon me?
It's a nightmare.
It is. Around Keogh to Gillum, around the world, or up back to Plaid Street, or even out to Shadowbrook and York Court. It's long overdue, and I think we need to do whatever we can to support you in these efforts. I share Tim's question. If it's going to be four lane or two lane, I know there was some discussion when the Rockwood Corridor to date was built, ended up with the median being two lane. It's pretty and it's pristine. I'm not sure it's the most effective use of that highway right away, but you also have existing houses on Rockwood that you didn't have below Front Street, so I'm sure that's an issue as well.
And cost will become a factor. We'll also need to design it where you can do some, hopefully some commercial development up towards the Glen Raven area. The other part of this is what you just said is our police and fire for response time getting that way. There's no difference. We have to send fire down Webb, but getting across, you can't cross from Edgewood over there.
Right.
So Station 4 responding from that way, it's just that really creates a whole other issue for us for EMT calls. So this is an important corridor. We have a lot of east-west corridors in the city. Think about it. You got Mebane Street, you got Church Street. We really don't have a real north-south corridor detached in the number of people live out towards Indian Valley and the northern part of the county coming through.
They got to come all the way in Webb and then
that's
go
right.
somewhere.
Or around Elon.
It's a bottleneck, okay. Yeah, it is.
Do you need a motion?
I'm going to ask for it now. Do I hear a motion that we adopt this resolution in support of the City of Bourbon? I have a motion and a second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. No opposed.
All right, tough you guys were. You're not so tough after all.
We're hard.
No, you knew we weren't tough.
Issues.
Thank you. Thank you, Bob. Thank you, CeeLo. Okay, the next thing is the CDBG policies. Amanda Whitaker with Hobbs Upchurch and Associates. Oh, Jason is here to do this.
I'm just here to introduce Amanda.
Oh,
he's
okay.
Going to handle that.
You don't look like a man.
You should have in your packets two memorandums and sets of policies and ordinances and with regards to the Economic Recovery Scattered Sites Community Development Block Grant. Which, just to remind the board, we were awarded that in late 2010 in the amount of $500,000, which we'll use for home rehabilitation and urgent repair, and then also our 2010 scattered site CDBG allocation this year, which is $400,000. The policies and procedures you have in your packet are part of what needs to move forward with administering the grant. And Amanda Whitaker is here tonight from Hobbs Upchurch and Associates, who will be administering these two grants for us, and I will turn it over to her this
time. Okay. Thank you, Jason. Hey, Amanda.
Good evening.
How you doing?
I am doing well. I hope you guys are. Can you hear me?
Sure.
Yeah.
Okay. Like Jason said, you guys have been awarded two grants from the North Carolina Department of Commerce, specifically the Division of Community Investment. The first grant is for $400,000. It's through the Scattered Site Program. This will allow the county to rehab five homes and relocate one home. The second grant is through their Economic Recovery Program, and this is for $500,000, and it will allow the county to rehab 10 homes and do what is called emergency repairs on 8 homes throughout the county. The Department of Commerce requires counties, towns throughout North Carolina that receive these grants to adopt a certain set of policies and procedures that go along with their guidelines for the grant. In your packets that you should have in front of you, you have a set of policies, plans, procedures, resolutions, and ordinances that are required to be adopted by the board. And I'll just go down the list, and if you guys have any questions, you can ask me specifically. The first is an equal opportunity policy, and it includes fair housing and procurement policies, especially Section 3, which has to do with low-income job creation. The second one is an acquisition and relocation, and this is basically about when a resident is displaced, making sure that they are properly put back into the housing that meets needs for them. A citizen participation and complaint procedure, a code of conduct, a 504 grievance procedure, a signature resolution, and a project budget ordinance. These are all required to be adopted, and it is for both grants. So you'll have a policy for the recovery grant and a policy for the scattered site housing.
Okay.
And I'll be happy to answer any questions.
I just had something come to mind. Is this something we could use to help some of the folks in northern Alamance that got hit with the tornado possible? Is that...
Currently, we did have to submit to the state a list of the houses we intended to do. However, sometimes things fall through. Sometimes we have some cost savings, so there may be an opportunity if we do have some cost savings to push that money in that area.
I mean, if it's possible, I think that would be just good to help some of the folks that weren't insured and so forth, and FEMA's not going to help them. So if we could possibly do that, I would certainly like to see that happen.
Okay. Some of these were at Belmont, right? Are these any of the Belmont homes, Jason, or are they over?
Near the mill. Mm-hmm. I don't believe they're penalty in Belmont. Okay. That district might be stopped. Okay. And I will just add on to Mr. Boswell's comment. We do encourage people that are interested, even though the houses have been, the intended houses have been selected, to still go ahead and fill out an applicant intake form. As we get grant funding or these opportunities present themselves, if we may county may choose to apply for an urgent repair grant this year that may be able to be used for something like that.
I think if we can do something for those folks that really got kind of caught in the middle there and the federal government's not going to help and so forth, I think it's time to step up and do something.
Any more questions? Okay, we need a motion on this. We need a motion to accept.
I'll make a motion that we accept it.
Okay, we have a motion to accept scatter sites grant policy, economic recovery grant policy. Do I hear a second?
Second.
Have a second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
No opposed.
Thank you.
Thank you. Okay. Next, we have budget amendments for Board of Elections and Board of Health. Stop me at three.
Madam Chair, Council, I come before you tonight to request a budget amendment in the amount of $20,358. These funds will be added to line item 241 and are grant funds received as a partial reimbursement for the 2010 early voting expenses. You have listed the intended expenditures for these funds, and there are no required county matching funds.
Anybody got any questions? If not, I'll entertain a motion to.
So moved.
Second.
All right. I have a motion and a second. All in favor say aye.
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 Thank you.
Yes, ma'am. Next is Mr. Bass, Health Department.
Honorable Commissioners.
How you doing?
I'm great. I hope you folks are tonight. We just have one little grant proposal here. Actually, we have received $1,000, basically an incentive grant for us participating in a study looking at a comparative of the child care coordination and maternal care coordination program when it was administered under the Division of Public Health. Now those two programs have converted into the pregnancy home model for pregnant women and for coordinated care for children, CC4C. It's being administered by the Carolina Care Network under DMA, so the folks wanted to do a pre and post study of what the program was like before the changes came about from the transition from the public health administering it to the Division of Medical Assistance. So we agreed to participate in a study, and for our participation they're giving us $1,000, which we're going to put towards educational materials for the program participants.
Any questions?
No, ma'am, it's just straight stipend.
Okay. Any questions? Do I hear a motion? We accept this budget amendment. A motion and a second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Thank you. I appreciate it.
Now, next is our county manager. We need to get out our little booklet, don't we?
thank you, Madam Chairwoman. What I would like to present to you tonight is the county manager's recommended budget. This is basically the same framework of the budget that we looked at 2 weeks ago at our meeting. Again, this is a budget that does not have a tax increase. And I'm not going to go over every line because it's about, with all the different departments and all the different grants that we do have, we're going to kind of get to the bottom line. If we look at revenues, our projected revenues are $127,081,293. We talked about earlier that we wanted to adjust our sales tax figures. We did adjust it up. We originally talked about adjusting up $1.5 million. We did not adjust the full $1.5 million. I believe it was $700,000 that we did adjust it. So we're trying to be very realistic, very cautious in our numbers as well. But we still feel very good with the property tax number of increasing, as we talked about earlier. So sales tax number is down from what we talked about 2 weeks ago. These are our recommended expenditures. And again, I'm not going to go through everything, but just look at the columns. We talked a lot this year about actual expenditures versus budgeted, and we showed you the 09-10 actual expenditures, what 10-11 budgeted was, the 11-12 requests from the departments, and what is recommended. So again, we won't go through everything at this point. What I would like to request, if there's something specific that you have questions about, let us know and we can get you the information of why cuts were made or why cuts were not made. So we'll be more than happy to do that. But this is just to give you an overall view. We will give you your what our plan is, and I'll talk about this in a little bit, is for the budget that is approved or that you'll have for the public hearing, it's going to be about 40 or 50 pages. And then once that budget is approved, then we will look at the big budget book, which will have the graphs and all the numbers and the figures. It'll kind of be the pretty book. So,
Craig, but before you leave that page, would it not be possible right in the middle to have a column showing 10, 11 actual through 9 months?
Yes, something like we can that? Do that as well.
I think that would be helpful, and then we can, in our own minds, annualize that.
Yes, sir. Be more than happy to.
But right in here, right where you have it, would be fine.
We can make sure we take care of that as well. But here's through all the departments.
How much cut is this here? Are you recommending?
Again, we are the total budget request for 11-12 was 131.8 million.
All right. So what's the
127?
What's percentage wise?
Didn't look at a percentage. Okay. Yeah, but we can get you that.
I just wonder. I can't figure it out on my head right here.
Craig, it's about a 4% cut.
About a 4%. Yeah. Okay. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you, Amy.
And then, again, just major items that we talked about that are still in the budget, $300,000 debt service for EMS. And, again, a lot of that's due to the savings that we made by changing our billing and collection service. We do have a $250,000 set aside for contingency. If we talk to a lot of the departments, we've cut them fairly tight, especially like areas of fuel. So if there are overages, we do have some cushion. Hopefully we won't have a lot of overages, and we can put that cushion back into fund balance. Again, one of the other things that we're looking at that's kind of a major change is temporarily closing the Prison Camp Road jail annex. And working with the sheriff, again, this will be a temporary measure, and I will have the sheriff explain it if he would like.
Yeah.
And how much
that,
that's
going to
save?
Well, it should save some money for the county. We don't have those exact figures, but what it will allow us to do is be able to not only get the place back up to the speed using inmates, which will save the money county, and that's what we're doing right now as far as painting and fixing it up. Right now, our federal U.S. Marshal prisoner population is down. Our ICE population is down, but that is going to go back up. And in the meantime, by temporary closing it, we'll be able to save money, of course, on your heating and air and some of the other function that goes on there. Plus, will give us time to get the prison unit back up to top notch and also be able to do our old and new jail addition here back up to where it should be by using inmate labor. The guards or detention officers that were down there will be brought up here using work crews to get this stuff to be done. We will also be doing some mowing and stuff because we do have enough people there to be able to do that at that time. It will also give us an opportunity. Every year, every one of our employees has to have 40 hours in service. Plus, we've been given, there's been a lot of overtime made because of having to work with the population that we originally had. Furlough days, bonus days, vacation, and sick. This will give us this manpower can be used to allow those people to be off that has got extensive amount of either vacation and overtime and hadn't been able to be off. And once again, we can reopen that place in 2 hours if we have to. We'll be able to reopen it in 2 hours.
Were we that far down in the retention of...
Let me tell you, I don't know how to say this, but I think Washington has had a lot to do with the downfall as far as inmates coming into our ICE. They've relaxed the enforcement efforts, I think, on the immigrants. I also think the U.S. Marshal, the bond policies and holding has changed a lot because the federal government is also feeling the same crunch that we're feeling. So right. They feel like, you know, we leave them out and
go where they can.
And however, I feel like that's probably going to come back around to bite them and us. And I feel like the population will go back up in the next couple of months, probably tremendously. We also stand a chance. Legislature's looking at a law where they take all the misdemeanors out of the state prison system now and put them in the county jails. If that happens, we're going to need every bed we got. And it's going to be going to cost the county some money. I can tell you that because they're not wanting to pay about $22 an inmate, and it runs around $45 to offset the cost per inmate.
Yes.
Any questions?
Let's hope that doesn't come to fruition there.
Well, the Sheriff's Association is doing everything they can to see it don't happen. I can tell you that. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you, Sheriff.
And again, appreciate the sheriff working with us on that. And again, is what we wanted to do is basically utilize the existing beds that we had and not have two facilities if we didn't have to. But again, as the sheriff said, once the numbers go back up, you know, if we do get more Marshall or more ICE prisoners, it's a very easy thing to open. We're not cutting off utilities. We're not doing any of those things, so it's available to use at any time. So, but again, we're not laying off any employees. They're really needed right now to fill in, again, as the sheriff talked about, the lapse time that we have on overtime and kind of catch up on some of those in-house training. Again, looking at county employees, again, we are not recommending this year no merit or COLA raises, no step increases. Again, the last raise that county employees have had was the 08-09 fiscal year. And hopefully, with things, you know, picking up, that it may be something we look at it next year as far as raises for our employees. The good thing is, if furloughs can be a good thing, is we're only recommending 2 days of furlough this year instead of 5 days, or 2 days for 11-12 instead of 5 days like we had this year. The two furlough days that we have, that will save us about $310,000. And again, we're looking at adding bonus days, which are vacation days that do not accumulate in time, but bonus days that the employees could have since we're not giving any raises this year. Next steps. One of the things I'd like to request from the board tonight is that there a motion be made to set the public hearing for June 4th at our next regularly scheduled 6th. I told you I'm dyslexic. June 6th. I'm sorry. I always get my dates wrong. We'll change that to June 6th at our next regularly scheduled Board of Commissioners meeting, and that will allow us the time to go ahead and advertise. We will then, whenever the board's ready, approve any time after that between then and June 30th. And then, again, as I mentioned earlier, at that time, before the June 6th meeting, you will get a more detailed copy of the line item budgets. Once the budget has been passed, we will take that and then make the budget book from it. There any general questions?
Other than what Tom had mentioned there, to put that where we actually are this year, I think that's a good idea.
Yes, sir.
So we'll know exactly what we're dealing with this year.
Yes, sir.
Okay. How about sales tax month-to-month comparison?
We have that.
I've got that.
Yeah, we've got that.
Can we distribute that?
Yes, sir, we can distribute that. I think Amy's already got copies made. Again, it is up a little bit, but it's still down a little bit over last year. We had a big $1 million refund in April, or it came in July, but it was in April's expenditure. And so
that's
we.
That's a non recurring.
Yeah, it's a non recurring, but it's kind of killed us on sales tax this year.
So you can asterisk that out for comparison.
Yeah, we can. So.
Okay, at this time I'll entertain a motion to set and advertise public hearing June the 6th.
So
have a motion.
Second.
And a second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. No problem.
Okay. Thank you very much.
We'll set that. Okay. Anybody have any more questions about from Craig?
No.
If not,
you've done a good job with that.
We'll
Thanks,
go,
Craig.
We got
also, I really do want to thank Amy and Susan for all their help and helping getting the PowerPoint ready tonight as well. So thank you very okay. much.
Does anyone want to pull anything from the consent agenda?
I'm okay with it. Everything.
If not, I'll entertain a motion to accept
so
the consent
moved.
Agenda.
Second.
All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. No opposed? Okay. Any commissioners' comments? We will go to commissioners' comments about anything y'all want to talk about. Quiet. Y'all want to go home, don't you?
Yeah, I think so.
This was a quiet meeting.
Quiet bunch
quiet
tonight.
Any announcements? We do want to.
Summit's Thursday. Yeah.
Tell Todd, Tom, we're sorry about your mom.
Yeah. Thank you. Reminding me of that.
Aren't you from EM Holt? Okay, yeah. You want to explain?
I thought maybe they were going to speak tonight. You said it's the next meeting.
Yeah, it's not on our
budget agenda. Public hearing.
Okay, all right.
Budget, yeah. I'm sorry.
Yeah.
Budget public hearing. You're Mr. Fuquay? Okay,
yeah.
Good.
So that'll be next time. Okay. All right. If we don't have any announcements, we are adjourned.
All right.
Thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners meeting. Meetings of the Commissioners Board occur at 7 p.m. on the first and third Monday of each month in the Commissioners' Chambers on the second floor of the County Office Building located at 124 West Elm Street in Graham. Changes to the meeting schedule will be posted on the Commissioners' website at www.alamance-nc.com. You can watch the most recent meeting of the County Commissioners on the second and fourth Wednesday of each month on Time Warner's local public access channel beginning at 10 o'clock p.m. You can also watch recordings of the most recent meeting and past meetings by going to our website at www.alamance-nc.com. Please visit our website for more information on watching commissioner meetings online. For technical questions about this meeting's online or television broadcast, please contact our county webmaster at webmaster@alamance-nc.com. Please note that this address is for technical questions only. Questions or comments regarding the content of commissioner meetings may be made to the commissioners themselves. You can find their contact information at the Alamance County website at www.alamance-nc.com. Click on the link that says Alamance County Commissioners to visit the commissioners' website, where you can learn about our commissioners, read minutes of past meetings, access agendas, and find other information about our Board of Commissioners. You can also send mail correspondence to the County Commissioners by addressing it to the Alamance County Commissioners, 124 West Elm Street, Graham, North Carolina, 27253. Again, thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners meeting.